Welcome back to the Ed Schultz Show. I'm Mike Papantonio. We have Lee Fong's going to talk to us. Lee Fong's investigative journalist, one of the best in the business. He's going to tell us how Republicans have actually figured out how to make more money on this deal of messing with the environment. Lee, you out there?
Hey, Mike, how's it going?
Going well. Paul Ryan, I mean, how does he, you know, Paul Ryan comes up with his blueprint on how he's going to make money by giving the oil industry and the energy industry more money. How did he do it?
Well, Paul Ryan has got this conceit where he's told the public and the media that his plan is more fair because it takes out all the special loopholes and tax exemptions and then lowers the rates. So we're, quote unquote, more competitive. But then when you ask him for details, again, his budget hasn't gone through committee, so no one knows exactly what the exact structure will be. Are you going to take away these billions of dollars in oil subsidies? I mean, these are some of the most wasteful subsidies we have because these oil companies are making billions and billions in profits. They absolutely don't need them. But when you press him on this case to live up to his words on the Paul Ryan budget, he says, no, wait. We're not going to take out those subsidies. We're going to take out the other subsidies for homeowners and et cetera.
And now we find out he's filed this financial disclosure that he and his wife own stake. They got a stake in this in four family companies that lease land. I mean, am I getting this right? They're actually leasing land in Texas and in Oklahoma to the very energy companies that are going to benefit. I mean, this is not 6 degree separation. This is an exact fit for Paul Ryan.
Right. He's collecting money from the same oil companies he's protecting with these subsidies. And it's unfortunate he's not called out enough because people are giving him the benefit of the doubt that he's taking away the subsidies when he specifically said he will not. And now this personal finance disclosure shows that he'll personally benefit from these subsidies. And it gets worse than that. I don't know if you saw the news, but Eric Cantor, the majority leader in the House, he's invested in this special ETF that actually shorts U.S. Treasuries. So that means if the debt, if we default on our debt, as Republicans are pushing us towards...
He makes money.
He makes money. He makes, I think he doubles his money the lower treasuries go. So, you know, it's almost insane to me that we're having this debate and not looking at how these members of Congress are personally benefiting from the policies they push.
Rick, did you see Lee Fang's article that he did? It's called Paul Ryan, Herman Cain in the Oil Industry. He talks about how about Ryan's father-in-law, Daniel Little. Did you see this part?
Right, I did. Yeah, Paul Ryan follows the great American dream. He married well. the road to prosperity is who you marry in the Republican Party, apparently.
Well, in this situation, the Daily Beast did this article where it's clear that, you know, the father-in-law, Daniel Little, runs companies, and those companies directly benefit by the very things that Paul Ryan's trying to push through. Chesapeake Energy, Devon, XTO Energy. I mean, that's amazing that you were able to find that, Lee.
Well, just look at the farm subsidies, too. I mean, yeah. Lee's hit on all of it. This is legislative inside trading. They are crafting the laws and the subsidies to benefit themselves.
So, Lee, what has Ryan's reaction to this been? I mean, you shined a light on it. People know about it now. What's his reaction to all this?
It's the same reaction that he's had all these past months, where he's not talking to aggressive or even critical media. He's only going on Fox News and conservative talk radio. He hasn't really been confronted with this question. And, you know, the week before he announced his plan, his big budget plan this year, he was in the first Koch meeting in Palm Springs this year, working with those guys, telling them the preview of the budget before it came out to the public.
You mean the Koch group? He was telling them what he was going to do. Yeah, okay.
So, you know, there's a lot of secrecy here. There's a lot of conflicts of interest. But unfortunately, you know, a lot of folks in the public are only seeing the rhetoric that they're throwing up on the ads, saying, oh, this just lowers the rates and cleans up the tax code. I mean, that number one is a lie. But number two, people aren't looking closer and seeing that there's major conflicts of interest here.
Okay, but there's no question that the most lucrative, the most valuable asset he has, that he and his wife, Jana, have, is their stake in oil and gas. I mean, how does mainstream media just ignore that? I mean, this is not out there. It's not even out there about the $30 billion in farm subsidies that he's trying to hold on to, and he has a direct benefit to those farm subsidies. Does he act, you know, is it just like an alternative reality? Like, well, gee, this isn't really happening, or what?
Well, the sad reality is that this isn't particularly a special case. You know, a lot of the top Republicans own stock in a lot of the corporations that they're defending. Jim Sensenbrenner has lots of oil stock. The Senator Ron Johnson had lots of stock in BB. Daryl Issa, who's attacked Democrats for even daring to try to investigate Goldman Sachs, has huge amounts of money invested in Goldman Sachs. So if you look down the line of top members of Congress who are stopping investigations, stopping regulations, stopping taxes, protecting subsidies, they're personally benefiting from these same companies.
Okay, let's jump up. The Herman Cain story. How crazy is this? Herman Cain wants to let oil companies run the EPA. Did I get that right? I mean,
aren't they now?
Yeah, they are. They basically are. But how far does he take the idea of the EPA being run by the oil companies?
Look, what Herman Cain said last week, and I did a little story on this, is that he was just simply more honest than the average Republican. He said he would literally appoint the CEO of Shell to oversee any oil regulations handed down by the EPA that would affect Shell. And he said it wouldn't just be Shell. He would look at the coal companies, the fracking companies, some of these other natural gas and oil companies. He would take the CEOs affected by EPA regulations and put them in charge of their own regulations. He said that's his plan. Literally, the CEOs affected by these regulations would be the ones writing these policies.
Well, I mean, I do have to agree. The oil companies are already in charge of the EPA. I mean, they're already running things. But he's saying, let's do it more directly. Let me choose the CEO, like, say, Peter Vosser, to head up the CEO of Shell Oil Company. Let's have him actually head up the EPA. And let's just call it what it is. I mean, we know they're running it right now, so let's let them make decisions about our environment for our children and our grandchildren. This is what Herman Cain said. He's almost like a caricature of a Tyler Perry movie, isn't he? You know, the Madea family. I mean, how do you get any crazier than that? And the Republicans are embracing him. They think he's a genius.
Well, if you look at it, Herman Cain is surging in the polls. He's actually run one of the best campaigns where no one thought he would have any chance. He's number two, number three. And a lot of the early state polls in Iowa, South Carolina, he's doing quite well. And I got to give Mr. Cain credit because, you know, he's saying he would literally put a Dutch multinational corporation, an oil company, in charge of the American EPA.
Right.
But the thing is, Mitt Romney doesn't disagree. Tim Pawlenty doesn't disagree. They just don't say these things in public. So I got to give Mr. Cain credit for at least being very candid about his intentions.
Yeah. Okay. And so what we have now, we have big oil that we'd like to say we have in, you know, we want to think we have them in check, but we really don't. I mean, you've got the Iowa Energy Forum. What is that? What is the Iowa Energy Forum?
Well, we just lifted the cloak on this new group. This new group started about 2 months ago called the Iowa Energy Forum. And I was in Iowa last week touring, writing a little bit about the campaign. And I just witnessed these people going up to me saying, you know, we're from the Iowa Energy Forum. We're a grassroots group. And they had their members going up to different presidential candidates, asking them about big oil priorities, particularly Canadian tar sands and this massive Keystone XL pipeline that brings Canadian crude oil through the entire continental United States to refineries in Texas.
So it's a new AstroTurf group paid for by the oil industry that's showing up at these town hall meetings to try to make Republicans think that the grassroots wants to give more to oil. Does that kind of
That's exactly the case. And it goes even farther than that, and that it gets them on record supporting some of the most dangerous policies. And because, you know, Rick Santorum was asked about this pipeline. He goes, you know, I don't really care. He starts talking about kind of like his ideology about free markets. And the guy who's working for this front group says, hey, Mr. Santorum, just to make it clear, you do support this pipeline, right? And Santorum finally kind of
He has no idea what the Keystone pipeline is.